loose items in the pouch in front of you.
Have a safe and informative journey.
Hello, I'm Nathan Hartman, and this is Dreamfinders, a podcast about the creative culture of Disney theme parks. We all have our favorite Disney cartoon characters. Sometimes we wear them on shirts or put them on backpacks, maybe even go to the parks and Disneybound as them. Well, Brian Hall likes to go to the parks as characters as well, just not like you and me. Here's Brian meeting Mickey and Minnie at Animal Kingdom.
Oh, you want to take a picture, pals? Oh boy!
Ooh, everyone's saying goofy!
No, Mickey doesn't talk now at the meet and greet. That's Brian. How about this exchange at a fast food drive-up window?
Hi, welcome to Whataburger. My name is Dora. Will you be earning rewards from your Whataburger ad today?
I do not believe that I will today. You don't happen to have any more honey butter chicken biscuits for breakfast, do you? I have a rumbly in my tummy for some honey.
Yep, that's him too. But that's far from all. Brian has almost a whole Disney vault's worth of voices he shares on his YouTube channel with his 2 million subscribers. Brian sat down with me to chat about how a simple online contest made him go viral overnight, what it takes for him to figure out an impression, and what it's like to do a voice at the parks for the characters themselves. All that and more is coming right up on Dreamfinders. Brian Hall, welcome to Dreamfinders.
Well, thank you. Glad to be here.
So to start, I am curious about your life growing up in Texas. Did you come from a real Disney-loving family?
No. I mean, we watched a few Disney movies here and there, but as I got older and I was still in love with Disney and everything, I had many talks with my parents about, like, Brian, you realize you're 20 years old and you're still loving Disney? Don't you see the problem with that? No. Which is great, because at first they were really concerned, but now after everything that's happened, they're my biggest fans. So it went from them being petrified that I still watch Winnie the Pooh to them calling and like, what you doing, Brian? Nothing. You got Winnie the Pooh. Put it in. Get to work.
Yeah. So. So clearly, because your family's not a Disney family, did you guys ever go to the parks or anything like that? Or was it sort of just because Texas is certainly not super close to California or Florida? Did you guys ever do that trip, or was it something just sort of that you always wanted to do?
We did that a couple times when I was young. Once where I was really young and I couldn't remember most of it, to Disney World, and then another time when I was around 10. But those were the only times that we ever went. And I tried multiple times to get them to go back. I couldn't get them to do it. They went to Universal, but they wouldn't go to Disney World. And I'm like, oh, come on, you guys. We're so close. It's just down the road.
Were there cartoons? You mentioned those cartoons. What were those, like, Disney cartoons that you grew up with? And were there ones that you sort of favored at a young age?
Oh, yeah. My favorite ones when I was a kid are, ironically, still my favorite ones now. It was Lion King, Dumbo, and Jungle Book. Those three I just couldn't stop watching.
In the same sort of vein of the question, though, was there a voiceover artist that later on, when you sort of recognized who was doing what, that you realized, oh, that really influenced me at a young age, that person is in this character and that character and that character, but I just never picked up that they were such an influence on who I am? Was there anybody like that?
That was definitely Jim Cummings. I remember the second I found out who this man was, like, there was something about Steele's voice in Balto that just always got my attention. I'm just like, what? I feel like I've heard this, but not from Balto. So this was back when the internet just started. So I went and looked it up, and I was shocked to realize that he was the singing voice for Scar and Winnie the Pooh and Tigger and basically everything you've ever heard before. And I'm just like, one man can do all of that? And it just shocked me. And ever since then, I was like, what is this magic that this man can do?
So when did you first realize that you had a little bit of that magic? Did you realize at a young age you had a knack for impressions, or was that something that came out later on in life with friends?
That was, I was relatively young. I was in middle school when I found this out. I was, I was watching an episode of Full House, and I saw that Joey Gladstone was going around doing all these voices. And for some reason, I thought in my head, you know what? I bet I could do that, too. And he did a Scooby-Doo impression, so I tried right after him. And surprisingly, I could do it. I showed it to my friends at school the next day, and they all lost their minds. And I'm like, oh, okay. Let's find more, because this is awesome.
What were those early impressions that you sort of dug into?
Yeah, Scooby-Doo, like I said before, was the big one. At this point in time, Lord of the Rings was still kind of big in everyone's mind. So, of course, I got my Gollum voice in. Mm-hmm. As far as Disney goes, got like Mickey Mouse pretty quickly. Goofy came along pretty fast also. And the Pirates films were going strong. So Jack Sparrow was everyone's favorite. I had to do Jack Sparrow like every day I went to school.
Run us through a little bit your process when it comes to doing that, because I don't know. I've always been fascinated by people like Rich Little, who, for people who don't know, is an impersonator from the 70s. And I grew up on his stuff, oddly enough. And I've always do you start with the idea that you can do it, or do you just sort of get into it? What was your sort of process, or what is your process now into fleshing out an impression?
Well, the first thing is really listening to it, trying to figure out what that voice actor is doing and trying to see if I can replicate that to the best of my abilities. And a lot of that comes through trial and error. So I'm sitting there, I'll listen to a scene over and over and over again until I can quote this character's lines word for word. I can hear it clear as day in my head. So once I do that, I'll go off and start experimenting on my own with trying out different voice placements and opening different resonating chambers in my nose or in the back of my throat or something else, and just trying different placements until I think I have found something that's right. And then I'll start doing the voice while the other voice is going, and I keep tweaking and tweaking and tweaking until I can't hear the difference between that voice and my voice. And then that's when I know I've got it.
Let me ask you about that tweaking, because that's a really nice verb for a lot of stuff going on. What aspects of the vocal technique? Is it diaphragm or inflection, or what plays a role in creating that? I mean, what switches are you flipping in your brain when you're wanting to do something like that?
Oh, yeah. All that plays a part. Diaphragm is huge. There's so many voices I wouldn't be able to do if I wasn't using my diaphragm. Or I could do, but then they would destroy my vocal cords, which you don't want. But yeah, the tweaks that I'm normally doing is that's when I start doing what I call the fine tuning, to where I'm like, well, the voice is almost there, but it's a little too high. Let's lower it. Or if it's a little too low, let's raise it. We need a little more gruff on that voice. We need a little less gruff. We need a little more. That's whenever I have the core of the voice down already, and it's just getting the fine details figured out.
So when you're doing that, I don't know, you'll say I need to raise it or lower it, and I understand from a singing perspective what that kind of looks like, but does it take training? I assume it does, to kind of internalize some of that stuff into how you use your vocal cords in those very specific ways.
It does take some training. I mean, I have never had professional training for voice acting before. Everything that I know, I've done on my own. Mm. But I was professionally trained in singing, to the point I had 10 years of private vocal lessons for opera and musical theater. So a lot of the stuff that I learned in those classes, I applied to my voices and to all that jazz, especially vocal health. That was a huge one. And so I took a vocal pedagogy class in college where they would teach you if you have a student that's really nasal and they're like, okay, just tell him to do this and do this, and then they're no longer singing nasal. I'm like, okay, so if I do the opposite, I'll get super nasal. And so I could really do that for a character who have a cold. So...
So you went to Dallas Baptist University for vocal performance, as you said. Was voice acting already what you thought your career was going to be at that point, or did you go in that thinking you're going to have a more traditional path?
I was thinking way more the traditional path. None of this was even on my radar. I was like, the voices are just something fun that I do for friends. It's never going to get me any jobs or any work. It's just what I do for fun. And then I was actually planning on going into church roles with this to go work in music ministry or children's ministry or something like that. Little did I know life had other plans for me.
So let's talk about those other plans. What sort of changed? What was the first thing? And I imagine it has a lot to do with your YouTube channel.
It has everything to do with that. So at this point in my life, my YouTube channel was not what it is today. It was not meant to be seen by everybody. It was strictly a glorified hard drive. I just put a bunch of videos on there that I made for work or church or school or anything that I just didn't want to keep on a flash drive, because you remember back in the day, it was hard to get a flash drive that was like 8 or 10 gigs, and these videos were huge.
Right.
So it was way easier just to upload something to YouTube and give a link at school and say, look, there's my project. There you go.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all it was. I didn't expect anybody to look at these. And then I made the Disney character singing Let It Go, just trying to win a $100 gift card to a Disney store because I found a contest online and accidentally went viral. And then I started getting called by people in Hollywood. So I'm like, okay, well, I got a new career path now.
So did you finish university, or was that in the middle of all of that?
Luckily, it was at the end of my college career when all that happened. I still had 1 year left when this happened, but I literally had 3 classes left to get my degree. So I worked with those professors and they let me finish online, and I still got my degree. I just finished the last year in California online. And so, yes, I have my diploma.
I'm curious about that actual experience. So that you talked about going viral, and man, I feel like we always hear about, like, well, everybody who has a company or whatever and wants a video is always saying, oh, I want this and I want that. And oh, I'd like to also have it go viral, which is not like a thing you can just plan. Like, it just either happens or it doesn't happen. And because you can't plan it, I'm curious about that transition for you from being a guy just on YouTube to, I'm assuming, being recognized in public. Was that an easy transition, or has it been strange?
It was extremely rough at first, but now it's not bad at all. But yeah, when it first happened, it was really rough, just because, like I said, I was just trying to get a gift card. All I wanted to do was go buy Frozen on Blu-ray. That's all I wanted. And then all of a sudden, I'm getting recognition from everybody all over the world and getting emails from people, and I can't go anywhere on my college campus without somebody pulling me over. And I'm just like, all I wanted was a Blu-ray. That's all I wanted. Can I get back to my life, please?
Yeah, you go from wanting Frozen to literally doing the voice of Olaf for a song during a Disney performance in concert. So it's quite the shift.
Yeah, it is. It's a huge shift. So, it was really rough at first. And I made a video on my channel recently going into all the details. But yeah, it was really rough at first, and it created a lot of issues with my personal life and just everyone around me. But eventually it all calmed down, and I moved to California, and I ended up really solidifying myself over here and building this career. And yeah, it really worked out well in the long run. It was just, when you're not expecting that and not trying to get that, and it literally changes your life overnight, it's rough. It's just really rough. And I don't think everyone could say they'd be okay with that, because it's, you know, it's a great thing going viral and all that jazz. But there's so much more that comes with it that no one's even anticipating.
One of the cool things about you moving to California is now that you're a more frequenter to Disneyland. And
oh, yeah.
Because of that, you do this really amazing thing on your YouTube channel where you'll go into the parks and you'll go to meet and greets with different characters, but then you will speak to that character in their voice. When did you come up with this idea, and what encounter do you think has been your favorite so far?
Well, I came up with it just because I was trying to think of cool ways to use my voice for videos, and I don't know why. I remember I was in the shower just thinking through things, and all of a sudden this idea popped in my head. I'm like, I'm not sure if that would work, but hey, let's give it a shot. Worst thing that happens is nothing happens. So I got my buddy to come with me and help me film, and I promised him dinner if he helped me film. So he came, helped me film, and that first video just did gangbusters. And we were like, oh, there's something here. So we just kept going and going, and I had fun. The characters were having fun, and oh my goodness, it was so great. I've had so many great experiences. If I had to pick the best one, this is going to sound really weird because it's my most recent one, but I went to Disneyland Paris about a month or two ago. And while I was there, I went to the Inventions restaurant up in Hotel Disneyland over there. Mm-hmm. And it's like a big meet and greet thing. And Pluto came in and I started doing the voice of Mickey to him. And he got so excited, he pulled in Donald. Donald got so excited, he went and got Mickey. And the three of them are right there just hanging out with me. And they're like, they get to the point where they're so excited, they just sit on the floor and just keep wanting to hear more and more and more. And apparently it left a big impact, because later I had a cast member come up saying, hey, they had so much fun talking to you, they want like a private picture with you after you're done. I'm like, oh my gosh, this is cool. So
I'm curious about like your headspace. Like, does it take, I imagine some impressions, it takes more to get into the headspace of a character than others, or can you just click into it? Because I know some impersonators need words or phrases that really get them into the voice. What is your sort of pattern with that kind of stuff? Is it easy for you to just kind of click into a voice real quick, or does it take a little bit of thought process?
It depends on the characters. Usually if it's like the Fab Five or like Winnie the Pooh and Tigger and all them, I don't need anything. I can just get into their headspace immediately and I'm good to go. For some of the other ones, it's a little tougher. So I'll be like practicing in the line as I get there, trying to make sure I get it just right and trying to get into the character's mind. But yeah, like if I do Stitch, he makes that little noise whenever he says yes, that little, that's what I use to get into his character. As weird as that is, I'm like, it's just a word, but I go, and then I Stitch can sell whatever he wants. It's just that little will get me fully where I need to be. It's weird how that works, but it does.
So what voices do you find that you do that are the like well, not even just the voices that you already have, but what sort of vocal ranges or things of that nature do you find the easiest to impersonate?
I guess it depends, because usually I'd say the lower voices tend to work better with me, just because usually if you go too low, it sounds cartoony, and the lower that I go, it would sound cartoony. So my voice naturally leads itself to a lower voice character. But at the same time, I do have a lot of high-pitched characters that work. So I don't know which one I necessarily say is easier. I know which ones are harder.
What would those be?
Women voices. Oh my goodness.
What's the uniqueness of a woman's voice that makes it difficult?
Well, the reason why, it's really an anatomical thing, because a male vocal cord and a female vocal cord, males tend to be thicker and longer, which is how you get a deeper sound, and women's tend to be thinner and shorter. Now, whenever you're trying to get a deeper voice, you have to go lower and lower and lower, and then you just keep stretching it out. Now, if you wanted to get smaller, you have to squish all that up. Now, if you're squishing up your vocal folds to try to get to where a woman's is, you can make it as short, but there's going to be so much extra skin and stuff, it's not going to sound realistic. Whereas theirs are thin, yours are fat. So just based on the nature of anatomy, it's almost impossible to sound like a natural woman. But if you wanted to do a really high-pitched, cartoony-sounding one, you can make that happen. Or a lower-pitched woman voice, yeah. So, like, I can get Minnie Mouse and Princess Peach. We're good there. But you start getting into, like, everyone wants to hear me do Elsa. And I'm just like, y'all realize how hard that is for me to sound like Idina Menzel? I understand other women being able to imitate her voice. But as a man, it's really difficult to do that. Which everyone thinks, oh, you can do Minnie's. That means you can do any woman voice, because I'm sure that's the hardest. I'm like, no, she's actually the easier one to do. When you start getting in that middle range, that's where it gets really hard. The higher pitch ones are easier to do because they already sound cartoony. So if I'm getting myself to that range, then yeah, it'll sound cartoony when I do it. So that fits. It doesn't fit with the natural sounding voice.
We talked about this earlier, and it was you doing Disney in concert. So you toured Europe as part of Disney in Concert Magic Moments. What was your part in that show, and what was that experience like for you? I mean, were you a world traveler before that, or was this all new experiences for you?
I wouldn't necessarily call myself a world traveler, but I had been out of the country before, so it wasn't my first time. It was my first time in Switzerland and Austria, and I'd been flown out to Germany about 6 months before that for something else with Disney, surprisingly. So it was new in the fact that this was the longest I'd ever been away from America. I was there for roughly a month, maybe a little over. And it was an incredible, incredible experience. Everyone there was so awesome to work with. And it was crazy because I was doing a show with all of these like rock stars and musical theater stars over in Germany. And I'm like, I do videos in my living room. And yeah, it was just incredible. So my part in this was I was the surprise guest, I guess, was what you say. Mm. So my main bit was that they asked me to come up with an impression song cover that I did specifically for the tour. And so I would come on, do that bit. But then I would also be a part of any of the main big choral bits where they needed every singer that they had to like do a big choir bit. So we did that with Let It Go and The Circle of Life. And I think we did that for Away Away for Moana, which was interesting because this show is for a primarily German-speaking audience. So I actually had to go learn all the German for all of these songs other than my bit because they let me do that part in English because I'm like, I could do all the characters, but I don't know if I can do it in German.
That's quite the feat, yeah.
Yeah, so I had to go learn like Circle of Life in German, which also had Zulu in it. And then we also had to do the Moana bit, which also had the Polynesian language. So I'm like, I had to do English, German, Polynesian, Zulu. And I think there was another language that I just can't remember right now. And I'm like, this is the most bilingual show I've ever done.
You also have done some work in commercials and you've worked for Air Bud Entertainment, to name a few. How is your process for preparing for voice acting different than doing just impressions, or is it very similar?
It's a little different in just the fact that instead of trying to channel into a character that already exists and I have to get into the brain of the character that I've been watching on TV or something like that, now it's I have to channel this character that completely exists in my imagination for the moment. Mm. So that is a little different in the fact that instead of, if I need to really do some good character art, I'll like pop up a video on YouTube and like listen to it on my phone real quick. So this one, I either have to pull up audio that I did for a audition or something like that to kind of get him back into my brain and be like, okay, what was I thinking when I did this? Okay, think that this, what can we add to the character to make him unique or something like that? So yeah, that's really where I'm going through. And I do a lot of vocal warm-ups, a lot. Just because I don't know what the character is going to need to do when I go into a recording booth, because a lot of times I don't get the script until I'm there. So I'm like, okay, I don't know what he's going to need to do. I don't know if he needs to scream. I don't know if he needs to sing. I don't even needs to know if he's going to cry, or I don't know what he's going to do. So be ready for everything.
Give us a little insight in a day of a voice actor. Like, is it a 9-to-5 because you're doing it in a booth, or do you come in for 5 minutes for some things and then pop out? Like, what can a day, I mean, I'm assuming it sort of shifts and changes depending on the job, but what's a normal day like in a voice actor's career?
It definitely changes on the job for sure. Most of the jobs that I get hired for, we usually have 3-hour sessions. So we're in there and I'm in my little booth and everybody who's the director and the recording artist and everybody is behind this piece of glass. So I kind of feel like I'm in an exhibit in the zoo. So like they're all just watching every little thing I do as I'm in front of the microphone. So yeah, I'll hear them in my headphones and then they'll say like, okay, Brian, we need you to work on this whenever you're ready. And so I do whatever they want me to do. Usually I have to do what we call ABC take. So that's where I do the exact same line 3 different ways with different inflections, different stuff. So what's the question? It would be like, well, why would you do that? Well, why would you do that? Why would you do that? And, you know, so we have a lot of different options to work with because I'm not with the other voice actors when I record. So they need a lot of different variety to match whatever inflection the other person did to make it feel as natural as possible. And sometimes it can be as short as 5 minutes. I remember the first job I ever did in Hollywood, I got hired to do a sound-alike for Dracula from Hotel Transylvania. And it was just for a little commercial promo. It was like 3 or 4 lines, nothing huge. And I went in and did all the lines. 5 minutes later, we were done. I was like, seriously? That's it? You don't need anything else? We're done? Okay. It took me longer to drive to the place that I did the job than it was to actually do the job.
Now that you've done all these voices and you've sort of made a name for yourself doing them, have you got an opportunity to meet some of the people whose voices you like to do?
I have gotten to meet a couple people like that. I've met Bill Farmer, who is the voice of Goofy, and he's just one of the nicest guys you'll ever meet. Just so sweet, and he was so supportive. Apparently, he knew about my videos and my channel, and he thought they were awesome. So I'm like, oh, dude, thank you. But one of the biggest surprise, he's not necessarily with Disney all the time, but he's done stuff with them, was Jess Harnell. He is most notably known for the voice of Yakko on the Animaniacs. Mm-hmm. But I believe he also did the voice of Br'er Rabbit on Splash Mountain.
He did. Yes, that's absolutely true.
I thought he did. And we were at a convention together. We were both talents. And it happened to be in Dallas where I grew up. And so I had a couple of friends who I actually knew growing up who went to this. And one of mine was my friend Gabriel. And he is a voice actor as well, and he was just getting started at this time. And so he went over to the Animaniacs booth and came back to mine and said, Brian, Jess was so nice, and he signed this for me, and he was so cool, and oh my gosh, it was so great. So I went over to Jess and told him, thank you for doing that. It really made my friend's day. And we were sitting there talking, and then he realized who I was, and he's like, oh, you're that guy! You're that guy on YouTube! Oh my gosh! He freaked out. And he was so cool and so nice. And it just happens that the Animaniacs booth was right next to where our green room was. So anytime I went back there to take a break, he would see me out of the corner of his eye. And he'd like grab my shirt, pull me down, and just be like, do Winnie the Pooh again. He was so cool. He was so awesome to me.
So now that you're sort of exploding onto the scene, as it were, what's your hopes for the future? What would you like to do? I'm sure it's a mix of all the stuff you're doing now, but is there something kind of far along in the tunnel that you can kind of see that you would hope to do one day?
Well, my ultimate dream would be to be the voice of a comedic sidekick in a Disney animated feature. That would be the ultimate end goal. Like, if I did that, I could quit my career and be totally happy and just go retire off in the woods somewhere. But other than that, it's just, I just want to be able to keep doing what I love and be able to still support myself off that. So I'm kind of open and game to whatever comes my way. But yeah, that'd be the ultimate dream, would be to do that.
So let's end our little interview here with something a little fun. What's currently a voice you do that you find that still makes you smile every time you do it? You love doing that voice.
Well, he's not Disney.
That's fine.
He just, yeah, he always, for some reason, when I get really excited, he just comes out, and sometimes I don't even mean for him to, he just does. And that's King Julian from Madagascar. I don't know what it is, but like when my best friend and his wife were about to have a baby, I was so excited, and I'd be like, oh, it's the little baby. What the little baby going to be named? We got to see the little baby. And I don't know why. It's just, he just popped out, and everyone got so mad at me. They're like, Brian, you're doing it again. I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. I'm just excited.
Brian Hall, thank you so much for coming on Dreamfinders. I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
And that's it for this episode of Dreamfinders. Thanks so much to Brian Hall for being my guest. Make sure to check out his website, brianhall.com, and his YouTube channel. Our podcast artwork is provided by J.P. Tanner. Find his other work at tanwoodcreative.com. This podcast is distributed by WDW News Today, the worldwide leader in Disney Parks news. Read all they have to offer at wdwnt.com. Dreamfinders is hosted and produced by yours truly, Nathan Hartman, who you can follow on Twitter at SomeStuffISaid. Tell your friends about the show, and please, please give us a rating and review on Apple Podcasts. Also, if you or someone else you know would make a great guest on this program, feel free to email us at dreamfinders@wdwnt.com. I'm Nathan Hartman, and remember, if we can dream it, then we can do it. Dreamfinders is sponsored by Never Grow Up Vacations, the official travel partner of wdwnt.com. Never Grow Up Vacations specializes in trips to Disney destinations around the world. So be like us and never grow up. Head over to nevergrowupvacations.com to book your next trip today.